here last week. Jim, it's good to see you, brother. A couple of quick announcements here before we get started. There's a ladies' luncheon coming up. You can check with the ladies at the back. There is a sign-up sheet that you can join that. We are looking for pictures. Glenridge Bible Church is about to celebrate its 40th anniversary, and we're going to be having a very special service at Agape Valley that morning. I invite you all to be there. My expectation is you all will be there because we're celebrating the faithfulness of the Lord with this assembly. And so if you have pictures over the last few years, over the last few decades, please submit them to the office so Glenridge can, or so that Jurgen can scan them in. We're going to have a nice presentation. We have a very special service plan. We can spend the day there enjoying hayrides and different games and things. So looking forward to that. And I did mention Jim, but there is a thanks here from Jim Bucknell, and I'll read it. A most heartfelt thanks to the prayer warriors of our GBC family for how the Lord lined everything up and the amazing response by so many, the swift EMTs, the great state-of-the-art emergency room and staff at the hospital with wonderful care and an amazing granddaughter-in-law and her alert, sharp mind as I lapsed into the biggie and she sounded the alarms, bringing a dozen-plus emergency staff in seconds. Great performance by all. My heart was not damaged, but the automated neurological connections were wearing out, so a new pacemaker takes over. So that's a thanks on behalf of Jim Bucknell and the family. Let's just open a quick word of prayer. Our loving Father, we just come into your holy presence this morning to thank you again for this Lord's Day. Every day is a gift from you. Every breath we take is a gift from you. And we thank you for these mercies every day, Lord. As we gather together now to worship you, help us to set aside the affairs of our lives, any difficulties we are facing, any challenges, anything that might distract us, Lord, and help us just to keep our eyes on Jesus. And so we pray this service is honoring to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. 250 years ago, Charles Wesley, to celebrate his conversion, wrote this song, "Over a Thousand Tongues to Sing, My Great Redeemer's Praise." Will you stand with me now as we sing to the praise of God? Stand, please.
Verse 58, 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord. All Our Father, as we approach the table this morning and we consider again the gift of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, we consider again the cruel cross of Calvary, of Golgotha, of the sufferings of our Lord. Father, help us enter into a deeper sense of gratitude, a deeper sense of awe and wonder at your grace. Father, help us to set aside ourselves, for oftentimes we are our own gods. Lord, we pray that you'd forgive us our sins and trespasses and help us, Lord, to be merciful and forgiving to others around us, especially during this time that we come to the table. Renew in us, cleanse in us, and give us new hearts to see again not only the Lord Jesus Christ, though that is of primary importance this morning, but of course of our brethren, so we may come to the table with a clear conscience and taking of the body and the blood of the Lord in an honoring way. In Jesus' name, amen. The Apostle Paul writes about the wisdom of God and compares it, or describes it really, as the foolishness of the cross, writing to a church struggling in 1 Corinthians, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. There is no man who would have written a story like this, the story of the gospel. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this age? Has God not made foolish the wisdom of this world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through wisdom did not know God, it pleased God through the foolishness of the message preached to save those who believe. For Jews request a sign, Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified. To the Jew a stumbling block, to the Greeks foolishness, but to those of us who are called both Jew and Greek, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. Because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. One of my favorite hymns that we used to sing at Ridgeville Bible Chapel during our Lord's table, it's in our hymn book in 208. We're not going to sing it, but I do want to read it to you this morning. It's the message of the cross, the power of God. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? There it says, alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as I? Was it for sins that I have done he suffered on the tree? Amazing pity, grace unknown, love beyond degree. Well might the sun in darkness hide and shut his glories in, when Christ the great Redeemer died for man, the creature's sin. Thus might I hide my blushing face while his dear cross appears, dissolve my heart in thankfulness, and melt mine eyes to tears. But drops of grief can never pay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. Again, Paul writes to the church in Corinth, instructions for the Lord's Supper, warning in the previous text of the divisions that were taking place in the church, the lack of reconciliation, the development of sects, of cliques in the church, and that is unacceptable in the sight of the Lord. And he gives a warning, and then goes on to the actual instructions of the Lord's table. And though we read this every month, I read it often in my own personal devotions, we need to allow these words, the somber reminder of the cost of our salvation and of coming to the table with clear conscience, examining ourselves, we must allow those words to again wash over us. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And so we were brought again into that upper room. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. And just consider that it's the Lord Jesus sharing these words with the apostles. He himself describing his death, describing this new covenant in his blood, the suffering that he would go through upon the cross. Do this for us to remember him. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord, as though we had hammered the nails into his hands ourselves, if we come in an unworthy manner. And so let a person examine themselves, and so let them eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many sleep. At this time, I'd like to ask the elders to come forward. And if you are a saved individual, that is, you have put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, his person and work on Calvary, you have examined yourself, the Lord calls you to come and to remember him. Please come. You are a guest here or joining us for the first time, or maybe just need a reminder, the bread is of course underneath the grape juice. There are two cups there. The bread is contained in the cup underneath the grape juice. Frank, would you please give thanks for the bread?
Heavenly Father, we come into your presence once again with hearts of joy and peace. Because you give that peace to us, a peace that surpasses all understanding. And when we come to a ceremony like this, where we purposely set our hearts aside to remember the precious gift that you gave to us through your Son, Jesus, the gift of salvation, Lord, what can we say but thanks? And we remember the brokenness that your Son, Jesus, went through, the beatings. We have different photographs and depictions of what we thought Jesus might look like, but Lord, I don't think anyone can really portray the pain, the suffering that Jesus went through. According to your word, he was beaten to a place where nobody could even recognize his face. And yet he did it for each one of us here. He did it for the whole world. That's how great your love is for us, and how committed your Son was to fulfilling the task that he was sent to this earth for. So we do remember, and thank you that we can have hearts of joy in that remembrance because of him and the brokenness. We ourselves had lives that were broken in the past when we lived in sin, but then we were redeemed and we were cleansed. And that brokenness was taken away because of the precious sacrifice on Calvary's cross. So we partake of the bread this morning in remembrance of that great and awesome day. And Lord, Thank you for the forgiveness of your sins through Jesus, our Lord. Thank you for your amazing grace. Amen.
Moment. In the quiet of this moment, let's continue to remember the Lord. Derek, would you please give thanks for the cup?
Father, here, together as your bride, purchased by the blood of Jesus, your scripture says, Lord, that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Our pastor has been taking us through the Torah once again, and we look at how you instituted the Passover, Lord, which the Israelites were commanded to take a spotless lamb and to take the blood and put it over their doorposts so the angel of death would pass over them. And this morning, Lord, as we hold this cup in remembrance, a sacrament, Lord, that you've called us to continue until Jesus returns, to take and remember this new covenant, Lord, that has been purchased by the blood of your one and only Son, a free gift, Lord, of grace given to those who call on the name of Jesus. So this morning, Lord, as we take this cup, may these promises just ring ever true this morning in our hearts. We pray this in Jesus' name and in his blood. Amen.
Almighty God, we thank you again for this time that we've had around the table as the church. We thank you again that we have been called out from the dominion of darkness. We've been rescued by your beloved Son. We thank you again for your faithfulness to your promises of a seed, a redeemer who would come born of a woman, born of the flesh, and yet the divine God-man himself, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who knew no sin, the one who had to be made in the likeness of sinful flesh. But Lord, we are amazed again at the humility of Christ. We are amazed again at the giving of his life, the suffering that he endured, both physically, most importantly, spiritually. We hear again the orphan's cry, my God, why have you forsaken me? And we are reminded of the extent by which you went to save us. And all we do is come with the praise of our lips, of our hearts, our minds, our souls, as we bend them towards you. by the leading of your Spirit, we come now to worship you and continue to worship you as we remember the Lord and exalt the name of Jesus. May this service be honoring to you. For Christ's sake, amen.
Grace is God's undeserved favor to us. We don't earn it. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, "For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast."
Maybe this morning you can relate to the words of the psalmist in Psalm 107. You feel like you are wandering in a desert, or you are a prisoner in darkness and deep gloom. Or perhaps you don't want to admit it, through foolishness and rebellion, you find yourself feeling alone and far from home.
Turn your eyes and your voice to our gracious God. Find hope and comfort in His enduring love for you. At this time now, would you please stand? And please join us as we lift our voices together in thanksgiving to the one who cares for us, the one who wipes away our tears and is willing to lift us from the miry pit.
You may be seated. Our final song is a song asking God to speak to us, to convict us, encourage us, nourish us with His word, and equip us to live for Him this week. Please sing along with us.
The ushers, come forward, please, as we return thanks for the offering. Father, in the Psalms we read, He who owned the cattle on 1,000 hills, the wealth in every mind. And Father, You own our pocketbooks as well. And we don't need to give back to You, but because of Your love, because of what You have done for us, we just give You thanks. And we praise You that we have this opportunity to thank You by our gifts as we give them to You. May they be used for Your honor and Your glory. So again, we just pray that You would bless the gift and the giver. In Your name, amen. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Are there any children who would like to come on up to the front and stretch your legs for a minute? Come on down. It's good to see you here this morning. You know, I have been coming to Glen Ridge Bible Church for 40 years. I have. And, you know, ever since I've been coming, we have always done what we just did right now. We took up an offering. And that has always been a part of our service for 40 years that I've been coming. But I've noticed something new recently, like in the last month or so. I have noticed that some of our older Disciple Land kids have been helping to pass the offering plates during the offering time. And that is something new because I've never seen that before. And I think that's wonderful. But, you know, it reminded me of something. Because when I was the age of some of you, probably Haley, your age, or maybe Luke, your age, I can't remember exactly, but I have been coming here a long time. I was sitting in a chair in the sanctuary, very much like you, and I remember the man. His name was Mr. Morris, and he asked me if I would pass the offering plates. And I said no. I was scared. I was very scared to pass the offering plates. I was afraid I would make a mistake and get all mixed up, and how did I know where to get them and how to send them back? So I said no. And I mean, that was okay. Sometimes it is important to say no to some things, okay? So this is not a little lesson on never say no. No, we should sometimes say no. But, I wanted to encourage you that it's also sometimes a good thing to say yes. To say yes and be willing to serve or be willing to give. As I thought more about it, I realized God has made people in his image. And God is a very generous giver. We sang songs about his grace that he's given so freely and so generously to us. And so he gives you and me, all of us really, it doesn't matter our age, he gives all of us opportunities to give. Whether it's we give our time or our ability by passing offering plates, or maybe we give out of, you know, our, I don't know, maybe other abilities that we have. Mr. Jurgen giving by playing the piano, or we give by smiling at somebody. We give by praying. We give by putting money into the offering as it goes by. There's many different ways that we can give generously too. And when we do that, because God made us to be people who give, because we're made in his image, when we do that, we find joy and we find satisfaction because he will always enable us to give whatever he gives us opportunity to give. If he wants us to give something, he'll help us to do it. So I wanted to encourage you because I know some of you are going to give of your time afterwards by collecting the little communion cups. That's a big help. And others of you might stay longer and you'll be able to give of your time by stacking up chairs and putting tables away. That's a gift to God. So be encouraged that even those little things are a generous way that you can give and show that you love Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we've been singing about your grace to us. We've been singing about what a generous God you are to us. We know that every good thing comes from your hand. And so we want to give also. We want to be generous givers of whatever gifts we have, whether it's a gift of time or a gift of ability or a gift of wealth. Whatever it might be that we have to share, help us to give freely because we love you and because we're made in your image. And would you cause our joy to rise as we are willing and we say yes to you and we give. In Jesus' name, amen. Kids, it's a family Sunday, so if you didn't get a Bible board, you can go and get one now. And we're going to listen to the message this morning together.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's nice to be back. I was very thankful that Tanner was able to take the service last week, and I was praying for the service, and I'm pleased that it went well, but it is good to be back in the pulpit. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Exodus chapter 35. The text will be on the board behind me, but if you have your Bible, please open there. Exodus chapter 35, we're going to begin in verse 4. If you're able to, please stand for the public reading of God's word. Exodus 35, verses 4 to 22 and 29. Moses spoke to all the congregation of the sons of Israel, saying, "This is the thing which the Lord has commanded, saying, take from among you a contribution," or a heave offering is the literal translation. "A contribution to the Lord. Whoever is of a willing heart, let him bring it as the Lord's contribution." Again, heave offering, gold, silver, and bronze. "Blue and purple and scarlet material, fine linen, goat's hair, ram skins dyed red, porpoise skins, acacia wood, oil for lighting, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, onyx stones, setting stones for the ephod and for the breastplate. Let every skillful man among you come and make all that the Lord has commanded: the tabernacle, its tent, its coverings, its hooks and its boards, its bars, its pillars and its sockets, the ark and its poles, the mercy seat and the curtain of the screen, the table and its poles and all its utensils or vessels, and the bread of the presence, the lampstand, the menorah, also for the light and for its utensils, its lamps and the oil for the light, and the altar of incense, its poles, and the anointing oil, and the fragrant incense, and the screen for the doorway at the entrance of the tabernacle, the altar of burnt offering with its bronze grating, its poles and all its utensils, the basin and its stand, the hangings of the court, its pillars, its sockets, and the screen for the gate of the court, the pegs of the tabernacle, the pegs of the court and their cords, the woven garments for ministering in the holy place, the holy garments for Aaron, on the priest, and the garments of his sons to minister as priests." Then all the congregation of the sons of Israel departed from Moses' presence. Everyone whose heart stirred him and everyone whose spirit moved him came and brought the Lord's contribution for the work of the tent of meeting and for all its service and for the holy garments. Then all whose hearts moved them, both men and women, came and brought brooches, earrings, signet rings, bracelets, all articles of gold. So did every man who possessed an offering of gold to the Lord. Verse 29, the Israelites, all the men and women whose hearts moved them to bring material for all the work which the Lord had commanded through Moses to be done, brought a freewill offering to the Lord. Our loving Father, we come now to give the offering of praise this morning. We thank you again for the cross of Calvary. We thank you again we can come into your holy presence boldly because of that man, the God-man Jesus, and the accomplished work, the finished work of the cross, and because of his resurrection, the first fruits, the life, the promise that we have in him. Father, we pray that this service would again honor you, would be a blessing to you, like a sweet, soothing aroma, like the old tabernacle. It would rise up into heaven and it would be acceptable in your sight because we do all these things for the sake of Jesus. I pray he's magnified this morning. I would decrease, your word would go out in great power and truth and transform us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you. Well, we've all followed the children of Israel from bondage to freedom, from poverty to provision, from external and internal threats to the covenant and God's amazing grace. We've witnessed their fickleness, we have witnessed their unfaithfulness, and we have seen their tendency to give in to their own insecurities. The children of Israel have seen the hand of God in their deliverance and suffered through the consequences of their sinful inclination toward him, that dictating to God the means by which they would approach him, and how they allowed the pagan worship practices of the world around them to influence and eventually overtake them in how they worship the Lord, which interrupted the entire tabernacle narrative. One of the questions we might have when we come to a text like this is, why do we bother even reading it? It seems very repetitive, and you're right, it is repetitive. All this has been described in the chapters prior to the episode of the golden calf, and they are described here again. But in the chapters prior to the golden calf, everything was written in the future tense. Here in our text, the Hebrew is in the past tense. It describes for us how when the children of Israel reached the point where the Lord's tent of meeting was outside the camp, now it is about to come into the camp of the Israelites. You remember that tent of meeting, that poor man's tent where Moses would meet with the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob outside the camp. That sobering reminder of that episode that interrupted the tabernacle narrative. The sobering reminder that their sinfulness had in effect caused the Lord to remove his presence outside of the camp of Israel. But Moses interceded, didn't he? Despite his own flaws and his own shortcomings, he rises to the occasion. He is the mediator and the rescuer, in a sense, of the people, pleading with the Lord to remain with them, not to cast them off, but to continue on this journey with them. And of course, we try to make sense of all of this from our unavoidably human perspective. It seems like, and someone mentioned to me this past week, it's the Torah is so repetitive, isn't it? And if we examine our own lives, it is also very repetitive. It seems like all they do is fail. They fail and fail and fail again. And the only light seems to be Moses. That's probably why the Lord directs Moses to record this right in the middle of everything that was going on with the failure of the children of Israel with the golden calf. He places this text right at the close of the Exodus account. This right in the middle of it all, a glimmering hope that despite their tendency to fail, there's this hope that the Israelites may have actually grown from the grace they've experienced. A text that shines forth the potential God's people have when they have a right heart, a right mind, and a salvific spirit before the Lord. This is the tabernacle project, the actual building now in the past tense of the narrative of the tabernacle, the tent of meeting between God and his people. All the articles, all the designs, the blueprints that Yahweh has given to Moses are now going to be acted upon to the letter. And in this moment, the children of Israel shine. They finally shine. They rise to the occasion of giving. So here, the stone tablets have been replaced. Moses has successfully pleaded with the Lord to go on with his people, calling on his grace, calling on his faithfulness to the covenant he made with their ancient ancestors, again, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And if God was going to dwell with his people, it would be at his direction, at his divine prerogative. The Lord will always dictate the terms of engagement between his holy person and his called out people. It will not be influenced by the nations around them. It would be established according to the will of God. And now with that episode of the golden calf, as I've mentioned, behind them, the divinely mandated law being restored, the actual building of God's earthly dwelling place amongst his people can begin. And so the call goes out. What do you need? You need time. You need talent. And you need the tithes of the people. There's going to be a need for selfless giving, selfless service, unwavering obedience rooted in a proper perspective of what we would consider our own resources, what we consider is mine. All things the Israelites seemingly lacked, that divine awareness, that perspective, at least up until this point. So now is the time. And the Lord has provided the time. We will see the Lord has provided the talent. And the Lord is the source of all their tithes that were going to be given for the building of the tabernacle. So, after emphasizing the covenant in the first three verses of the chapter, and the Sabbath in the first three verses of this chapter, the call now goes out. Everyone in the nation now has an opportunity, was called to have a part in building the tabernacle, to giving toward the building of the tabernacle and the actual erection, the building up of the tabernacle. In verses 4 to 9, Moses calls the nation to give what's called a heave offering. It's really this idea of what is being given in addition to their tithes, in addition to their regular giving, is a heave offering that they're going to give for the building of the tabernacle. It's really it's the idea of that this offering that they're giving is lifted up for a higher purpose. They would come, they would bring their offerings, and they would bring them low and literally heave them up into heaven and saying, Lord, this is yours, use it for your glory, for your purposes. That is the heave offering. It was an offering made to Yahweh. Whoever's heart urged him, let them bring it. The list of supplies the Lord calls for includes gold and silver, bronze, various colors of goat's hair, dyed ram skins, acacia wood, oil for lighting, spices, incense, other precious stones, all very valuable to the individual, all very valuable to the nation collectively. Now, naturally, the question is, when we consider this is the first generation of slaves that have made their way out of Egypt, we're only 3 or 4 months into the episode here, where did this last generation of slaves from Egypt acquire all these precious metals? Goat's hair, well, sure, the tribes of Israel had their herds. We experienced that during the plagues, where Israel's herds of cattle and livestock were protected from the plague that killed the livestock of the Egyptians. So we know that they've already been established with livestock in Egypt. They've brought their way out. But these slaves had no money. They did not have gold or silver or precious earrings and jewels or onyx stones. So where'd they get it from? By God's grace. It was the Lord himself who supplied them with those as the Israelites were leaving Egypt. And you got to kind of search back into your memory a little bit. After the plagues and after the darkness, the Lord said to Moses, tell the people to borrow. Really, the Hebrew is plunder. It is to demand. Each man from his neighbor, each woman from hers, speaking of their Egyptian neighbors, objects of silver and gold, Exodus 11:1-3. Now, whatever the reason was, the Egyptians gave them exactly what they asked for. Whether the Egyptians now respected the children of Israel after the plagues and the power of their God, maybe it was somehow an atonement for the regret the Egyptians had for the way they treated the Israelites all these years and the suffering they were now going through at the hands of their God. These gifts, so to speak, were given over to the children of Israel willingly. These gifts were going to be heading out of Egypt with the Israelites. These gifts have even been referred to as, quote, the Passover war spoils, end quote. But again, either way, the Lord proves faithful to his promise, a promise that we reach even further back to the time of Abraham in Genesis 15:13-14, that his descendants would be enslaved for 400 years, but that they would be delivered, and the oppressive nation would be judged, and the children of Israel would come out with many possessions. This picture reminds us of the provisions of God. The way in which he faithfully and graciously provides everything his people need. Now, I want to stress this. God does not provide everything necessarily that we want. It's a very simple truth, and yet we struggle with it. Sometimes I'm guilty of this, but I'll use my children as an example because they love it when I use them as an example. Everyone looks over to them, yes. They're probably burying their heads right now, so I just won't make eye contact with them. Dad, I need an airsoft gun. I'm almost afraid to ask. Dad, I need this video game. I need this type of clothing. And you know what? We're all guilty of it. You don't have to be a 12-year-old boy or an 18-year-old girl. You don't have to. You can be of any age. I've been guilty of it. And sometimes I have to graciously remind them and myself, no, what I need is salvation. What I need is, in this world, shelter, food, water. Those are things that the Lord graciously provides for us. And in his immense grace, he sometimes provides us with things that we want. But the thing is, the Lord provides everything for his people. He provides everything we need. He is the source of everything. Everything that we say is ours is not, in fact, ours. It's his. For every beast of the field is mine. Richard mentioned this morning the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird of the mountains and everything that moves in the field is mine. If I were hungry, I would not tell you for the for the world is mine in all its contents. That's Psalm 50, 10 to 12. Even our lives, that very breath you just took is a part of his grace. It's his provision to us in this world. For in him we live and move and exist, Acts 17 and 28. He's the source of everything we have and be. Even our own existence finds its source in Almighty God. Whether it's ministry, whether it's practical living, whether it's the offerings we bring, our service in his name, living holy and blameless before him, our personal skill sets that we have, equipping us for life, he knows our needs and willingly supplies. God will always provide whatever is necessary for any task he calls us to. And for the children of Israel, he has provided the very materials by which he commands them to bring a heave offering. Gold, silver, fine linens, and precious stones. But not only that, in verses 10 to 19, we see it's the Lord who calls and provides capable, talented men and women to construct the tabernacle. Skillful men who would go on to construct the tabernacle's boards and bars and pillars and the furniture, like the ark, the mercy seat, the table of showbread, its utensils, the menorah, and so on the list goes. Women contributed by weaving together the garments for Aaron and the priesthood. And even though God called for these provisions, it was always he who provided them. It's always interesting to me that God provides us more than enough. But not so much that we can somehow free ourselves from depending upon him. In the building of the tabernacle, the Lord calls forth skilled workers, equipped with just enough of a particular skill to contribute to the project. But they had to rely on God for the vision, the pattern, the provisions. They never stopped needing God throughout the entire project. And that's one of those great truths of Scripture in the believer's life today, the reality that God has provided us with more than enough, individually, corporately as a church. But not so much that we can be independent from him. There always has to be a balance between ability and inability, an awareness of that. A Christ-centered focus can help us from the snare of pride or the pit of insecurity and ineffectiveness. An awareness that can deliver us from our fears of insufficiency or being tempted to lusting after fame and recognition. This understanding, it's very sobering, and the church must be rooted in it, that everything we possess finds its source in our all-sufficient Savior. In the New Testament, we see the Lord providing for the hungry masses with a handful of fish and loaves of bread in Matthew 14 and all the other Gospels. He returns a dead son to an old widow in Luke 7, something that that woman needed. He even provides the apostles with a pattern of how to pray. Again, we find that Christ is the source of all things that we need. But on a larger scale, when it comes to the church herself, it is Christ who provides for our needs. We could look at physical needs like food and clothing and shelter. But more importantly, that which is eternal, salvation, sanctification, and sufficiency. It's the Lord who provided the church with the apostles. It's the Lord who gives teachers. It's the Lord who gives preachers and pastors and elders. It's the Lord who blesses us with friendships and fellowship. He clothes us, he provides us, he clothes us in his righteousness and provides with us the armor of God. That's not something that we can grasp at. He gifts us with everything you see in this building. Look around you, the very seat you're sitting on. That's a gift of God's provision. Look at the building herself. I don't know why I refer to inanimate things in the female. I think it's a guy thing. But look at this building. All you, those of you who were here when we transitioned from one lakeshore to here, knows that this building was provided by God. It was a miracle. So there's that ongoing tension that we still need God. The continued need to lean into Him for His guidance, to keep returning to Him for strength and leading, and to be reminded of the peace we have with Him through His Son, Jesus Christ. Sometimes we forget that. And He is gracious to provide that reminder in His Word. The divine wisdom of the Lord never leaves us fully sufficient. You know, people, when I was asked to come and to follow Pastor Dave, I said, listen, I don't sing. I just don't. I'm not gifted at it. I think I'm fabulous. But if a poll were taken, there might be two people that would say I'm good, and I'm pretty sure they're my two youngest sons. It's just not something. So I am not all sufficient to meet the needs of this assembly. No pastor is. No person is. No elder, no individual, no lay person is. It really requires us to keep returning to Him every day, acknowledging that every accomplishment, every possession, every raw skill or talent, everything we have is from the Lord. Even, like I said, that last breath you took. We require the Lord's grace to provide it. Now, another parallel between the Tabernacle Project and the church today is the beautiful picture of God's people co-laboring together, shoulder to shoulder. God provided the blueprint to the tabernacle. The instructions for the tabernacle, they had to be followed exactly as they were laid out, to the T, to the point, right to the very last letter. He provided the materials. He provided the time. He's provided the skilled workers. He's provided the leadership under Moses to accomplish the task. Well, that's the church today. This consistency and harmony in the way God organizes His people throughout the Scriptures. We bring practical offerings, which the Lord has blessed us with. And we're supposed to give with a cheerful heart, not begrudgingly, knowing that what we give back to the Lord is already His. And He is so gracious to accept back to Himself what is His. We have skilled workers in the church. Some are trained. Some are called to lead. Some are called to advise. Again, the Lord, it's His provision. It's what He provides in the church. Some sing, some play instruments, some do the work, some to help and give towards supporting the work. Because everything that we need, the Lord has provided within an assembly. And so if we point and we say, we're lacking here, and we're lacking there, and we're lacking in this area, and if we say the Lord provides us with everything that we need, then the question is, who hasn't stepped forward to offer that? Oh, it's so easy to point a finger. It's so easy to say, we need this, and we need that, and we need to do this. What have we done as a church to address it? Because God gives this assembly everything it needs. Maybe you play an instrument. Maybe you play a guitar, and you're looking up at the stage, and there's no guitar player. If you can play the guitar, it's your responsibility to the Lord to provide that. We look and we say, there's a project that needs to be done. Why isn't anyone giving when in your bank account you've got like 19 digits in there? Then it's your responsibility to give. There's so much suffering in the church. There's so much sorrow. There's so much heartache. I wish someone would give of their time to minister. And on your wall at home is a diploma saying you're a certified biblical counselor. Then it's your duty to give that as an offering to the church. But not out of guilt, but out of an earnest heart that seeks to glorify God, to meet the needs of His people. Wherever the Lord has called each one of us, it is our obligation in the light of the cross to help in the church, to help continue building the sanctuary of the Lord today, which isn't confined to a tent in the wilderness, but within the hearts of all believers today. We have to continually remind ourselves that everything we have comes from God. Wisdom, knowledge, our skills, our material wealth. It's all from God. It should all be used for God's glory. Now, I'm not saying don't pay your mortgage because you want to give that to the church. We have responsibilities. You have a responsibility to develop skills, to develop crafts. Too much that has been given, much is expected. But that which is the Lord's is rightfully His. Consider what it takes. I'm not a businessman, but we have some very successful businessmen in part of our assembly. And so some of the questions I asked are, what does it take to build a successful business? There are certain sacrifices that have to be made if it's going to be strong and successful. You have to be willing to invest a lot of time. The Israelites were in a period where they had the time. There were no enemies around them at this point in time that had their crosshairs set on the children of Israel. They had time. They're at the foot of Sinai. They had the time to do it, to devote building the tabernacle. There's no command to depart from Sinai. So they had time. But what's interesting here, and I want to emphasize this, is I didn't read the verses, but I mentioned them briefly. They were commanded to observe the Sabbath in the opening verses of this chapter, because even though the tabernacle project was critically important, the Sabbath rest wasn't allowed to be broken, even for sacred work. Isn't that interesting? The work was incredibly important. They were building the earthly dwelling place of the Shekinah glory of God. And yet, the Lord says, you must take a Sabbath rest. The concern was this, that the Israelites might have worked right through on the Sabbath. But that day of rest stood on different ground. No work, not even the building of the Lord's earthly sanctuary was allowed. But that's one of the challenges the church faces today, a lack of time. We have busied ourselves alongside a world that does not sleep. We're tempted to fill our calendars with meeting after meeting, event after event, function after function, and we leave little room for the rest the Sabbath offers us. You can even fill your time with godly things. Bible study after Bible study. I got Bible studies every night of the week, prayer meetings every night of the week. Church functions, concerts, and though those are good things, the danger is we leave little room for divinely worshiping the Lord of the Sabbath in the quiet moments of life, to rest. And we don't because we're so exhausted from everything else. We leave little opportunity to go and be alone with the Lord and rest. 6 days we work, one day we rest, and that was even the mandate for the children of Israel during the building of the tabernacle. So even though, and I'm not going to get into a debate of Saturday and Sunday, I'm not getting into all of that, the church isn't explicitly commanded to observe the Sabbath according to the Jerusalem decree of Acts 15. But that principle remains in effect. That hasn't changed. Loved ones, we need to rest one day a week and not even allow what we might consider to be, for lack of a better term, godly things to interfere with that rest. Spend that time with the Lord in a quiet and refreshing rest. Could you imagine the children of Israel as they're building the tabernacle, as they're dedicating their lives to this project, and that one day when they practically needed to rest, they were able to just sit and observe the progress of the tabernacle and how encouraged they must be, how refreshed they were in that day. One of the big mistakes I see in the gym, and I can be guilty of at times too, is you work out 7 days a week, sometimes twice a day, and you never take a break. All you do is you break down the body because there's no time for it to repair itself. And so God tells the children of Israel, take the time to rest. Now, the Lord won't strike us down if we don't observe the Sabbath rest. The Lord won't strike you down, but you will destroy yourselves. We'll destroy ourselves. We'll lose that precious communion with the Lord. Never get so busy that we forget the Lord. Now, I'm going to go through these last 2 points very quickly. The next is you need, and just say it, you need money. You need money. As distasteful as that might sound, you can't have a successful business without capital. You can't have a church entity like this with all of our practical responsibilities without finances. You can't tell St. Catherine's Hydro, I live in Welland, we have Welland Hydro, listen, can I catch you next time? Listen, we're a church, we're a non-for-profit, do you mind just kind of, hey, we don't really want to pay that anymore. What do you think is going to happen? I'm almost tempted to tell Jürgen to shut the lights off, because that's what will happen. You don't pay your water bill, what happens? Your water gets shut off. Can't take a shower. Can't use the toilet. We had a broken toilet in our house, and I was sick for 2.5-3 weeks. I kept going in there to try and work on it, and you know what? When you have 7 people and you're down to 1 toilet, you start to appreciate water. You need money. And that's what the Lord blessed the children of Israel with and the church today. Gold, silver, precious metals, fabrics, and so on. According to Haggai 2 and 8, silver is the Lord's, gold is the Lord's, says the Lord of hosts. And so he has the divine prerogative to allocate these things according to his good will. Moses gives an account of the materials and the cost of the tabernacle in Exodus 38, verses 21 onward. The general estimation, because when we consider the tabernacle, we consider the tent of meeting, we consider it this sort of dreary thing out in the desert. But according to general estimates, the cost of the tabernacle, applying the value of gold, silver, bronze, onyx stone, so on and so forth, applying the cost today, it would cost the church, if we were, let's say we're going to build a tabernacle, precisely to the weight and size and dimensions of this, gold, silver, bronze, etc., etc., the cost would be anywhere between $63 million to $1 billion. Let me say that again. $63 million. Conservative estimate. And that does not account for man hours. It's all volunteer work. But as valuable as it was, I just want to stress this, as valuable as it was, what is that to hold the glory of the Lord? It's insignificant. And the amazing thing is that when we consider the conservative estimate of what the tabernacle would have cost, Moses faced a crisis of too much generosity from the children of Israel in Exodus 36 and 4. They're given too much, Moses. You got to tell them to stop. And they gave it all with a willing heart as an offering to the Lord, not grudgingly, not out of necessity, but as a worshipful act. And the Lord, as I said, allows us to offer it of his own. Anyone in the church that gives an offering, we're called to make it with a willing and cheerful heart. Whatever that offering is, offer it with a heart that realizes we are offering back to the Lord what is his. And very quickly, it requires sacrifice. Sometimes it requires for us to give above and beyond what we may feel like we can offer, financially, practically, in practice, in our time, in effort. Each of the children of Israel, no matter their social status or personal portfolio, were all called to contribute to the tabernacle project. No one person was too big, no one person was too small to participate. And we can say the exact same thing of the church today. Christianity, life in a vibrant, dynamic church, is not a spectator sport. It requires the efforts of all believers. Each believer has been called to become personally involved in the building of the church. It isn't only the pastor's responsibility. I have my responsibilities. It's not just the elder's responsibility, but we have our shepherding responsibilities. It's not just to the deacons, though they have their sphere of responsibility, or just church leadership. The board will take care of it. We all have a responsibility to be personally involved in the building up of the church today. For the Lord Jesus said, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and your fruit should remain, in order that whatever you ask in the Father's and ask the Father in my name, he will give you. John 15:16. Now that call originally to the apostles has fallen to us. And finally, this is the final, because you can see my notes. This is my last page here, and I'm halfway through. The instructions had to be followed to the letter. I've mentioned that. Each measurement, each piece of furniture, each pole, as insignificant as it might seem, each grommet, each curtain, everything had to be constructed exactly the way the Lord commanded. Why? Why? Because it is the Lord who dictates, and I stress this again, the way we can approach him. And at that time, there was only one way, through the ministry of the tabernacle. Change nothing, alter nothing, leave nothing out. But now we approach the one true and living God, to the one who said, and change nothing, alter nothing. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. John 14:6. That gospel message cannot be altered. What a precious gift the Lord has given us. And that message, like the blueprints for the tabernacle project, has to be followed to letter, because there is no other way to approach God. And the sobering thought I'd like to leave us with is this: none of us can outgive God. How do we know? Because he gave us his son. I'm going to close in prayer this morning. We're going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to close in prayer. I'll give thanks for the meal. And of course, you are all welcome. Even if you didn't bring anything, stay, have a time of fellowship, hang out. There's lots of good food. You don't have to worry about that. If you want to start with dessert first, go for it. No rules here. But I'll give thanks for the food. And as I'm praying, the ensemble will join us on the platform. They will give the benediction. And that will be our time to dismiss. Let's pray. Our loving Father, we just thank you again so much. We consider everything that you have given us, all these gifts you have given us by your gracious hand. We consider just even practical things, our homes, our cars, our health, our all these things that we see every day, Lord. But we thank you so much for the giving of your son, the gift that you gave us on Calvary. And we thank you for the gift of hope, the assurance of Christ coming again. We thank you again so much for this assembly, for this church, for everyone that calls Glenridge home. We want to pray for those who are still sick and still suffering at home. Lord, we pray you'd be merciful and your hand would touch them and bring them healing. And Lord, as we considered all that your hand has provided, we thank you for this food. We thank you for the hands that have prepared. We thank you for the hands that gave of their time as an offering to set up the gym, to set out tables and chairs, for the hard work of all those behind the scenes, Lord. Pray that you would bless them in a mighty way. It is such a joy to serve the Lord. And so we would ask again, as you have given this meal today, that again, a sign of your provision and care over us, that you would bless it, you would bless the hands that have prepared it, that you would bless it to our bodies to nourish us and strengthen us for this day, and that you would continue to strengthen us spiritually. You'd continue to grow in us Christ-likeness until that upward calling. That you would bless our time of fellowship together, because that fellowship is rooted in the Lord Jesus Christ. So we thank you for that this morning. We just thank you again that you are our God. In Jesus' name, amen.